We are very happy this morning to have with us Swami Harinamananda from the Vedanta Society of Southern California, Prasun Maharaj. He is an inspiring speaker, much beloved in across the different ashrams in the United States, in Canada too. And he's an excellent and able spiritual leader. He heads the Vedanta monastery of Vedanta monastery at San Diego, and it's a wonderful community. San Diego is a happy place, and the Vedanta monastery there is a very happy place indeed. You will see, it's always people with a lot of smiles. Under his able leadership, I have seen in the last few years, but I've been going there, I've seen how it has become a very vibrant Vedanta community. Besides the regular classes, he has involved esteemed, very well-regarded philosophers like Sthaneshwar, Timal Sena, and others. There are regular scripture classes. There are, of course, lecture sessions. Other Swamis come in visiting, giving talks there. They have a wonderful choir which he has inspired. It's a very musical center also. And another unique feature I saw which he has introduced there is that the puja, the ritualistic worship which is done there, involves everybody, which is not normally something that is that we see in Hindu temples, but it involves everybody. So if you go there and there's a puja, the Swami will lead the services, but you can all participate in that. And a number of other innovations. So he's always up and doing and very creative across a number of fields. We are very lucky to have him with us this morning from all the way across the country. He's going to speak on the living photographs of Sri Ramakrishna. So it's a great pleasure to invite Swami Harinamanandaji. Swami.
Good morning, everyone. So today let's begin with a chant. And in San Diego, we like to make things participatory. So if you know the chant, chant along. Asotoma.
Om Asato Ma Satgamaya Tamaso Ma Jyotirgamaya Mrityor Ma Amritam Gamaya Avir Avir Maeti Rudrayate Dakshinam Mukham Tenamam Pahinityam Tenamam Pahinityam Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi.
Lead us from the unreal to the real. Lead us from darkness to light. Lead us from death to immortality. O Lord, guide us through and through and ever protect us with thy loving presence. Om peace, peace. Well, thank you, Swami, for your introduction. But he forgot to mention one important part. It seems that the center of San Diego becomes vibrant and very living when he comes. He has not seen it when he's not there. In fact, as many of you know, he was there in San Diego just a couple weeks ago. And he created shock throughout Southern California. There is a 95-year-old devotee, the oldest devotee in our San Diego center, and she's actually originally a New Yorker, a Jewish New Yorker. And afterwards, she drives 1 hour to come to the center. Afterwards, she wrote me an email. She goes, "Some swamis comfort the disturbed." This is regarding Swami Sarvapriyananda. "Some swamis comfort the disturbed. The New York swami disturbs the comfortable." Just when I'm in a pretty good, comfortable spot, the Swami sends me into a new dimension to explore the yet unknown. This is Swami Sarvapriyananda. So he's creating a shockwave wherever he goes, and I don't know what I'm doing up here. It's very intimidating. I feel he should speak here, but I figure that in order for you guys to know what good food is, as Swami Swahaniji used to say, in order to know what good food is, you have to taste a little bit of bad food, okay? Then you can appreciate what good food is. So maybe I'm not so bad, but you can appreciate it more. So today's topic is on, as Swamiji was saying, it's really on the images of an avatar. We're going to look at the different images of Sri Ramakrishna and explore into it the meaning, the symbolism, and how it can deepen our spiritual practice. You know, in any type of visualization, if you try to visualize Sri Ramakrishna, you'll find that it helps to get a depth of knowledge, a little bit of knowledge about what you're meditating on. Also, it helps to become more familiar so that the familiarity will help lock in the image in your mind. And especially it helps to make an emotional connection. So today, as we explore the images of Ramakrishna, we're going to try to increase our depth of knowledge. We're going to try to get a little bit more familiarity as to who Sri Ramakrishna is. And finally, how can we create an emotional connection? You know what's amazing? I don't know if you're really aware of this. Prior to Sri Ramakrishna, how did we see God? How did we see images of God? We saw images of God basically from someone's vision of God, and then they depict it onto a medium. They'd paint it on a painting, or they'd make it an imurti. So what we see here, as I know, is the first time that God in a human form is captured in film. So what you're looking at is a direct representation of who God is here. It's not somebody else's vision. It's amazing. I mean, it's something to really think about. And as a photograph, does this photograph have some special qualities so that is it something different from a photograph that we normally see? A photograph maybe of our relative, of our friend. Is this something else that links us, that takes us back to a divine source? So we're going to explore these dimensions of the image of Ramakrishna. We're going to see why these holy images are important. What is the history of the photo and what do they signify? And how can we use them to deepen our spiritual life? And most importantly, how can we connect with them? When you're looking at the image of Sri Ramakrishna, what mood is it invoking in you? Really important. What mood is it invoking in you? So normally, when we see images, they convey a message. So when you see an image like this, by the way, I like to do things with call and response. So what message comes to your mind when you see the image here? Just shout it out. Okay. So sometimes we think of freedom. Self-determination, yes. Independence, right. What about this image here? What comes to your mind?
Destruction.
Destruction.
Human suffering.
Huh? Human suffering. Also the aspect of power, isn't it? What about this image here?
Discovery.
Adventure. Do you remember? This is Neil Armstrong. Do you remember the statement he made when he landed? What was the statement? Yeah, one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind. Okay. So every image that we see conveys a message. What is the message that's being conveyed by the images of Sri Ramakrishna here? When you see them, do they give you a sense of mystery, a sense of awe? Is there a sense of wonder? Do you feel a sense of transcendence? What do they appear to be telling you about yourself? What does the image appear to be telling you about yourself? Holy Mother had shared a statement. By the way, before I go on, how many images of Sri Ramakrishna, actually, how many photographs of Ramakrishna were taken? And for those that saw the video previously, don't answer. Anybody else?
Four.
Anybody else? Three. Okay. So there were actually six photographs of Ramakrishna that were done. Okay, out of the six, five are actually things that we have, right? And out of the five, today we're going to talk about the three images. Two of them were taken after his Mahasamadhi. So let's see, what did Holy Mother say about images and the photograph of Ramakrishna? Well, she said here, she says, the body and the shadow are the same. And what is his picture but a shadow? If you pray to him constantly before this picture, then he manifests himself through the picture. It's a very interesting statement. You can meditate on this for a day, see what comes out. The body and the shadow are the same. Seems like what she's saying to me is that in order to have a shadow, what do you need? Huh? A light source. But what, in order to have a shadow, what must be there? A body, an object, a body, right? And what is this picture but a shadow? She's saying that the photograph here of Ramakrishna is nothing but the shadow, right? But for a shadow to exist, what must be there? He must be there. The being of Ramakrishna must be there to be able to cast this shadow. If you pray to him constantly before this picture, what happens? The being of Ramakrishna emerges from the shadow, emerges from the unknown to make himself known. This is her words. It's really interesting thing. Ramakrishna is here right now, casting his shadow. There was another conversation about Sri Ramakrishna, and this is from the Gospel of Ramakrishna. It's M in Sri Ramakrishna, and gives us a little bit of who Sri Ramakrishna is.
You explained clearly the other day how God incarnates himself on earth.
Tell me what I said.
You told us to imagine a field extending to the horizon and beyond. It extends without any obstruction, but we cannot see it on account of a wall in front of us. In that wall, there is a round hole. Through the hole, we see a part of that infinite field.
Tell me what that hole is.
You are that hole. Through you can be seen everything. That infinite meadow without any end.
Sri Ramakrishna was very much pleased. Patting M's back, he said, I see you have understood that. That's fine. Very interesting conversation Ramakrishna is having here. What is this communicating? Well, to me, it seems what Sri Ramakrishna is saying is that we, each of us, has a wall that's limiting us. What is that wall? Ego, let's just call it Maya, right? We feel the sense of limitation, where our awareness is feel limited to our body. It's encapsulated through our skin. My awareness extends up to my skin, but doesn't go beyond. So this is me and that's not me. My mind puts limitations on me. I'm imprisoned by my mind, by my own beliefs. I can do this, but I don't think I can do this. These are the limitations I experience by my own ego. I identify with this, but I don't identify with that. So it seems to me what Ramakrishna is saying is that we all experience these limitations. But there is a hole through these limitations. It's called the avatar. And if we go through that hole, we will experience our infinite pure self. And I love Swami Sarvapriyananda's definition in the Vedanta Sara, the satyam gyanam anantam. You're infinite. In your perspective of time, you're infinite in respect of space, and also of you're not limited to any particular object. You are infinite. And in this sense, when Christ says, I am the way, the truth, the life, no man cometh to the Father but by me. Or Krishna says, abandoning dependence on all duties, take refuge in me alone, I shall liberate you from all your sins, grieve not. Seems like they're saying that they are the avatars, and through the whole, we can experience our infinite freedom. So when I look at these photos then, to me, they represent tirthas, divine passages, sacred passage to the divine. If you meditate on Sri Ramakrishna, it feels then that you can cross over into the infinite, to experience your infinite side. Is Sri Ramakrishna a tirtha? A tirtha is not only a one-way passage where it says here it's a crossing place in the sense of a transition or junction, okay? It's not only a one-way passage where we can cross over, but it's also a passage where the divine can enter into our realm. So it's like a two-way passage. God can descend and we can ascend. And why meditate on an avatar? Because they represent the bridge, the link between the human and the divine. Ramakrishna would say there are two in here. There's the devotee, and there's also the divine mother. They connect with our human side and pull us into our divine side. That's the beauty of an avatar. So, what I'm going to do now is we're going to talk about the different photos of Ramakrishna. We're going to talk a little bit about the history, the meaning and symbolism, and what our authoritative sources have said, and then what is the image trying to convey to us. And before I go on, let me tell you that most of the, if you read, there's three articles that talk about the images, and they talk about it more in a historical sense, what happened in history. In order to do this project, you know, when I was a young boy and I'd see these images of Ramakrishna in my house, and what do they mean? And then my dad would say, they're God. Yes, but he has all these expressions. What do they mean? So this was a discovery process. And I had asked about half a dozen swamis and some different people to try to come up with some different meanings. And what I found was that everybody mostly had a different interpretation. So today, I will give you a series of different interpretations, and then you figure out what you like best, what resonates with you, right? So this is a completely exploratory, it's a interpretive piece, all right? So let's look at photograph number one. Ramakrishna is in Keshab Sen's house, Sunday, September 21, 1879. Remember, this is just a static shot. There was a whole history that built up before this shot. That's what we're going to dive into. Keshab Sen, a noted reformer and leader of the Brahma Samaj, invited Sri Ramakrishna to a Brahma festival at his house. The well-known singer, Trailokyanath Sanyal, was present. Swami Raghavananda, a disciple of Swami Brahmananda, said this about this occasion.
The devotional music threw Sri Ramakrishna into ecstasy. He uttered the word Om and stood up, raising his right hand. His outer senses left him and he went into samadhi. Fearing that the unconscious body would fall to the ground, Ramakrishna's nephew and attendant, Ridoy, supported Sri Ramakrishna. Ramakrishna probably had been wearing his chadar either over his shoulder or hanging folded from his left shoulder, as is the custom. But when Ramakrishna rose, the chadar fell to the ground. Ridoy picked it up and tied it around his waist for safekeeping. At this point, Keshab had taken the photo.
Okay, what I'd like you to do is stare at the photo, get a good impression of it in your mind, and then close your eyes. This is part of visualization here. What do you observe? Vaikunthanath Sanyal described such experiences as, when the master was intoxicated with the joy of kirtan, we felt his divine body was as bright as molten gold and soft as cream. He was dancing in a semi-ecstatic state, slowly and rhythmically. While he was pacing back and forth, his left hand would be held slightly up and his right hand raised, his left foot forward and his right one backward. There's a unique expression on his face. Let's open our eyes. So what's the meaning of this? Well, during Sri Ramakrishna's time, one Swami told me that the ambient religion in Bengal was the Gaudiya Vaishnava tradition, just like Protestant Christianity is the prominent religion in America. So at that time, as I understood, Sri Chaitanya's devotional love for Krishna was the prominent religion in Bengal. So probably, Ramakrishna was overwhelmed by the music, stood up, and began to dance in the traditional Vaishnava way when he went into Samadhi. Now, four copies of this print were made, and one of them hung in Keshav Sen's house, the person where Sri Ramakrishna is, where he's at right now. And in the gospel, there's a conversation that occurs. Rajendra to Keshav. Many people say that he, pointing to this picture, is an incarnation of Chaitanya. Keshav, looking at the photograph, one does not see such samadhi. Only men like Christ, Muhammad, and Chaitanya experienced it. Now, when you look at his hands, his body, you see there are different expressions. These are called mudras. And mudras are basically physical gestures indicating your mental state of consciousness. And in this case, in Ramakrishna's case, they're the spontaneous outflow of his deep inner awareness expressed through his face, his hands, his fingers, and his body. So when we look closer at the photograph, we notice that his hands are in certain positions. Swami Premananda, a direct disciple, the Swami over there, third one from the left, had stated that looking at this photo, he said, the right upper right hand indicates everything is there, and the left hand, not here in the world. Swami Shraddhananda, a Swami, a highly spiritual soul, who was in our Sacramento Center, he had written an article about this particular photograph called Cosmic Meditations on Sri Ramakrishna. And in it, he states that Ramakrishna's right hand is fully stretched upward, and the two fingers are as if vividly pointing towards that timeless reality which the words of the Vedas and Vedanta try to indicate but become silent. He goes on to say that this right hand is what's one known as the Vashishta star. The Vashishta star is like a very bright star. It's pointing to something called the Arundhati star, the very faint star. He's saying basically that looking at his right hand, what is known is trying to indicate what is unknown. He goes on to say that his left arm is bent at the elbow, and the forearm is held in a horizontal position, and the palm is held upward, the fingers widely stretched apart, indicating what he calls a vairagya mudra, the detachment from the world of senses. Very interesting if you look at that left hand, okay? The Vairagya Mudra. What is, if you remember, like in Buddhism, how do they describe the world? They say the world is suffering, right? So, you know, there was a Buddhist monk that told me the meaning of dukkha, which sometimes we equate as suffering, is the opposite of sukha. And the real meaning of sukha, he said, was to be at ease. And he described it in the Buddhist time, it was like the wooden wheels was rotating around the axle, and if it was a smooth ride, that meant it was sukha, the ride was at ease. If there were chips on that wooden wheel, then there'd be a bumpy ride, and you'd feel dis-ease or uneasiness. And what he's saying with this left hand here is that we are all experiencing this uneasiness in life called the gap. And what we're trying to do is we're trying to fill the gap in any which way, through relationships, through food, through TV, through the internet. We are experiencing this emptiness. And this is going to be a little bit of a gross example, but it really hits it on the head. What happens? A professor of economics says, we try to fill the gap, and what ends up happening? And he drew a sort of a graph here with the quantity and enjoyment quality, and he used beer as an example. And he said, if you take the first glass of beer, you feel really good. The second glass of beer is not as good as the first, but it still is good. The third glass of beer is not as good as the second, but still good. And the fourth glass of beer gives you what's called an optimal buzz. Okay. I'm not speaking from personal experience, by the way. Okay. The fifth glass of beer starts to make you nauseous. The sixth glass of beer starts to make you vomiting. And the seventh glass of beer, you pass out. Everything in life, you experience a diminishing sense of return. It's the reason why we go to a restaurant and we have a really good time at that restaurant. The food is great. And then we come back and invite our friends and family. And then what happens? It's good, but it's not as great as the first time. So everything in life is like pouring whatever you want. It goes into your hand and it comes out. And ultimately the feeling is emptiness. And ultimately you feel dukkha, this uneasiness that we're constantly trying to satisfy. And then Swami Shodhananda goes further on to say that the smile on Ramakrishna's face states that everything is here, meaning inside. You don't have to go out to get it. Could that be a possible meaning for this photograph? If we take a more technical approach to looking at the hands, we see that the right hand is forming what's called mriga mudra. If you want to do this, make a mriga mudra, you see? This is what we call mriga mudra. And it's the deer mudra. Why do you think it's called deer mudra? Heads of a deer, right. What happens if an intruder comes into the deer's pathway? The ears go up. Signifies alertness, consciousness, awareness. Sometimes I was taught when I do puja that when I offer something, if I'm offering incense, with full awareness, I give this to you. Mriga mudra. The left hand is showing, it's called the Alapadra mudra, a fully bloomed lotus. And regarding lotuses, Sri Ramakrishna had a mystical experience and said this.
I saw a boy, 22 years old, exactly resembling me, enter the Sushumna nerve and commune with all of the lotuses, touching them with his tongue. The different lotuses of these centers, 4-petal, 6-petal, 10-petal, and so forth, had been drooping. At his touch, they stood erect. At last, the 1,000-petaled lotus in the heart blossomed. Since then, I have been in this state.
So here, can it be implied with this photograph that Thakur Ramakrishna is saying that when all the lotuses bloom, when all the chakras open up, you become aware of who you are, pure awareness, pure consciousness. Is this what this photograph is saying? Swami Atmarupananji, our Swami in Houston, had another interpretation of this, and I liked his interpretation. What he stated was, let's go back. He stated that this photograph is actually the Kumra Mudra. Now, a Kumra Mudra we use this in puja. It's a meditation pose, right? It represents a tortoise. And so as a tortoise, what does it do? It retracts its limbs. So when you hold this mudra, what begins to happen is you start to retract your awareness, which is going out through your senses. It starts to come back in and focus in. And you hold it in the thing you're meditating on. But what Swami Atmarupananda is saying in this photograph is the left hand is the bottom portion of this mudra, and the right hand is the top portion of the mudra. Why is he saying this? He's saying that the divine is so vast, so expansive, that it cannot be contained. And so to speak, the top blows off. It's ungraspable. It's not holdable. This is the divine. And when Swami Chidananji told me that a South Indian dancer had seen this photograph of Ramakrishna in the early 1900s, and he didn't know who Sri Ramakrishna was. And he said, according to Natya Shastras, the classical dance, this pose represents the infinite. Is that what this photograph is implying to us? And when we look at his face, what do we see? Well, Swami Vijnananji Maharaj, a disciple of Sri Ramakrishna, said, this photo of Ramakrishna's face is Anande Futifata. Anande Futifata. What it means is, it's a type of melon, a long melon, that has grown and it's about to crack. It's cracking. There is so much joy in Sri Ramakrishna that his face is cracking with joy. So when you look at the photograph overall, could it be that Sri Ramakrishna was listening to the songs of the divine, sitting down, and then felt a surge of divinity start to rise within him? Almost like a rocket, he starts to explode off the ground, and he spontaneously moves into a rhythm, a beat, and then he shoots or explodes into stillness, the stillness of samadhi. And what's interesting is that they had these big field cameras that would take these photos, and the cameras required about 2 seconds of exposure. So if there had been any movement, the image would have been blurred. And what else is interesting is, look at the, look at the audience. Look at the people sitting down. What are they looking at? Okay, that's good. So the people on the left, you see, are mostly looking at him. The people on the right are looking at the camera, the latest in technology. They're so interested in the world. This has caught their attention. So if we were sitting there, right there, would we be in awe of Sri Ramakrishna, or would our attention be directed towards the world? Where would we be? So what I feel this photograph indicates is that the non-dual mood. Do you feel a sense of stillness, freedom, and permanence when you see this? Look at Ramakrishna's eyes. They're closed to the world, unaware of anything happening outside. Look how indrawn, detached, and he's rising above any turbulence. And his face is expressing peace and joy. Does it depict, I am pure consciousness, not concerned by the play of nature? I am Purusha, unclutching myself from Prakriti, flying away, free. Does it depict, I am the formless I, non-locational, eternal, not subject to birth and death? All perceptions, feelings, images, sensations, they rise within me. They float, and then they subside. But I am not affected. I am an eternal joy. Is this what this photograph is depicting? These are things you should ask yourself to see what resonates with you. So what I feel then, this photograph actually represents the transcendental aspect of the divine, Brahman. There's a meditation that Swami Abhedananda has written in our puja. And in this, it describes Sri Ramakrishna in three different ways. So today we're going to be talking about the three aspects of the divine. Hridaya Kamale Madhye Rajitam Nirvikalpam. It describes Ramakrishna as the undifferentiated truth beyond all dualities, one without a second, as the infinite Brahman. Is this what this photograph is describing? Let's look at photograph number two now. This photograph was taken as studio portrait of Ramakrishna at December 10th, 1881 at 3 p.m. at Beau Bazaar at the Calcutta Bengal Photography Studio. So the photographer who actually took Ramakrishna's photograph in the first photograph in Keshav Sen's house, now Ramakrishna is at his studio. From the Gospel, it says, Surindramitra took the master in a carriage to the studio of the Bengal photographer. The art of photography was explained to him, and he was shown how glass covered with silver nitrate takes the image. As the master went into samadhi, he was photographed. Now, Sri Ramakrishna did not like having his photograph taken, And the only way you can have him get to take his photograph was if he was unconscious of it. So immediately a question arises in my mind. Why did Ramakrishna go to a photography studio? It was taken, but why did he go there in the first place if he didn't like his picture taken? Yes, there you go. So according to Swami Vidyatmananda, who had written an article on Ramakrishna's photographs, he stated that Ramakrishna had a lively interest in the things of the day. He had gone to the zoo, the theater, the museum, and many other places. So the gospel says that Ramakrishna inquired and wanted to know about the process of photography, how photography is done. And when he was explained this, all of a sudden, this was a trigger. It triggered him. He understood the spiritual implications, and that elevated his mind, and then a photographer was ready to take the photograph. What were those spiritual implications that elevated Sri Ramakrishna's mind? Well, Ramakrishna says about this experience himself. He says this.
Today, I enjoyed very much the machine by which a man's picture is taken. One thing I noticed was that the impression does not stay on the bare piece of glass, but it remains when the glass is stained with a black solution. In the same way, mere hearing of spiritual talk does not leave any impression. People forget it soon afterwards. But they can retain spiritual instruction if they are stained inside with earnestness and devotion.
Very interesting. What's happening at the time, you have these glass plates and you have to stain them with a black solution. And then the image is reflected on this solution and it captures the image. If you don't have any black solution, the image just goes through the glass and you don't have any capturing of the image. Ramakrishna is saying here that we all come to these spiritual talks, but how much of it actually sticks with us? And if so, why doesn't it stick with us? How much of it goes in one ear and goes out the other? And he's saying, what you need is, Swami Chidananda described it, is the emulsion of devotion. You need to, he says, you need to be earnestness and devotion. In one sense, we can call this, you need hunger. Either you're seeking a true seeker or you're truly in love. But you need this so that the information you get can then be incorporated and assimilated and transformative. So this photograph now, when I tried to find out if there was any meaning to this, I couldn't find any. But the photograph was actually used in a studio painting. And this was inserted in the oil painting, illustrating the harmony of religions. And in this picture, you see Ramakrishna, You see Ramakrishna on the very right-hand side. And he's talking to Keshav Sen. And he's showing that all these different religions proceed to the same path. You have a Christian church, a mosque, and a Shiva temple. And then you have a Vaishnavas, you have Shiva worshippers, a Jain, a Muslim, a Christian. You have Jesus and Chaitanya dancing together, and you have kirtans going on inside. Now, what's amazing is this is done in the 1870s, 1880s, and it's depicting the harmony of different religions. It used to be that we depict, okay, you have Shaivai Shaktas and the Vaishnavas together. Here we're expanding. I was asking some person, could this be one of the earliest depictions of different religions coming together? I don't know, but to me, it could be something that is foreseeing the future. And another thing that comes to mind here is that when we think of harmony of religions, I belong to the interreligious society in San Diego, and I've been noticing there was a Jain saint who talked about religions, and talked about religions are in three concentric circles. The outer concentric circles are the customs, the do's and don'ts, the rituals, the protocols of religion. And that's when I go to the IRC, that's what most people talk about. In the inner circle, there's the practices. We do selfless service. We do meditations, prayers, study the scriptures. At the heart of the circle is the experience. And when you go to the experiential aspect, that's where you see the different religions are very similar. they're talking about the same thing. That is what Ramakrishna is here speaking about. Jyotama Totopat, all religions are leading to the same ultimate experience. So Ramakrishna said this about the photograph. He said, yes, it contains everything. This is the ideal of modern times. And when you observe the jacket here, Ramakrishna is wearing, there's a Swami Nirvananandji. Oh, first of all, when you observe the photo, you see he's wearing a jacket. His right arm is on a studio prompt. The hand is facing, where is it facing? Downward to the earth, all right? And so we'll talk about that, okay? And what you observe is that his eyes are open. And Swami Nirvananandji Maharaj took this jacket. He actually got it from Kashipur, and he measured the jacket. Here's Ramakrishna's jacket, a different jacket that he wore during Kalpathuru Day. Okay? But he took the jacket, measured it, and then calculated ratios based on the photograph and determined Ramakrishna's height was 5 feet, 9 inches and a quarter. And Swami Chidanandji had told me that he was taller than actually Swami Vivekananda, who was approximately 5 feet, 8 inches. So, what do the hands signify? When you look at the right hand, it's different from the first picture in two ways. In picture one, the hand is pointing upward towards transcendence. Here, it's pointing down towards the world. Second is that the thumb in the right hand was inside. The thumb here is out. And when I look now, I'm going to stretch the meaning of this. When I look for the meaning, I couldn't find a traditional meaning according to our puja. But if you look at the universal meaning of sign language, what does this mean? Anybody? Love. Exactly. Love. And the second hand is facing like this, right? Okay. So in puja, we have a thing called Avagunta Mudra. Avagunta Mudra is like, we build this. It's in this direction. What it means is veiling. Okay, it's putting a protective cover. Sometimes you'll see the swamis, when they have food there, they'll do this to the food. They'll veil the food, demark it, put a subtle covering around it, a protective covering, designated for the Lord. In this position, Ramakrishna is in the reverse Avagunta Mudra, which means unveiling, uncovering. What is he uncovering? The mysteries of this universe. So, here, when we look at the photograph, to me, it indicates the immanent aspect of God, the personal aspect of God, God who creates this world and God who uncovers, unveils this world, God who projects out this world and God who brings us back from this world. The presence, as our Swami Sarvapriyananji talks about, Ishvara is that consciousness which pervades the entire universe, Saguna Brahman. And it is also that consciousness that responds to you, responsive consciousness. As Swamiji was telling in San Diego, that Brahman doesn't respond to you. He actually asked, who's asking the question? If you're there to ask a question, you're asking it to somebody. And that is Ishvara. If you're not there, if you dissolve all together, there's just Brahman alone that exists. So here we're talking about the personal God, that consciousness that responds, the consciousness that you worship, that you pray to, and that responds to you out of their grace. Swami Chidananda, so in the right hand, then, this is the hand pointing towards the world. And it's out of love, out of complete love, the overflowing love, that the one becomes the many. Eko aham bahuyasyam. I am one. Let me be many. And it manifests itself into infinite species, infinite modes of knowing, infinite knowers, and infinite things to be known. And it's very remarkable that you'll see something like, you could see a hand, and according to me, I can see this as a hand with this type of shape. But according to bees, they'll see this in ultraviolet light. According to dolphins or bats, they may see this in echo or through sound. So they're all experiencing the same thing. We're all experiencing realities as different perceivers. And God is within each one as the antaryamin, playing in each one of us. And Swami Chinnanji goes further to say that the two fingers that are out represent duality. And the three fingers that are up represents the unmanifest Brahman. Triparasa amritam divi. Three quarters of our experience is in the unmanifest, and a quarter of it is in the manifest. And when we think of duality, we think of the pairs of opposites. Every experience in life has this sense of duality in it. You may remember, how many of you watched the Super Bowl last year? This last year? Anybody? It's okay, sports is good. Okay, I loved sports. So, remember the very last play of the game, Tom Brady was back, and he threw this long bomb, and then it was going out, and then once the ball was dropped, and it was determined New England is not winning, that moment, the right-hand side, Philadelphia fans were up in joy, right? At the same moment, you have the New England fans who are in disappointment. Every experience in the world has this dualistic component to it. Another thing is when swamis come to Hollywood, we usually take them to the happiest place on earth, okay? Disneyland. And if you can see, I have to show it to you. It's okay to walk here. So if you can see, here we have Swami Atmagyananji, okay? You have Krishnamurti Maharaj from South America, and this was when I was a brahmachari. Now look at this. Look at Swami Atmagyananji. Although he's wearing a t-shirt called Life is Good, okay, look at his face. Look at his fist. They're all white. He's got white knuckles. He's holding on to like dear life. And his face is all crunched up. So although he's wearing a thing called Life is Good, he ain't feeling so good.
He's smiling though.
No, well, he's on the surface. And then you have Krishnamurti Maharaj and myself. Look at us. We're really enjoying this ride. And what's really strange is that the person behind me, do you see him? Look at his face. He's like completely sattva. He's just immersed in something. There's no expression. He's just in bliss. So to me, this represents what we call the three gunas. You have tamas, our attentions in our body. You have rajas, our attentions in the world. And then you have sattva, attention is within oneself, okay? And if you want to know really something strange, if you look at the person behind me, look at this woman here, if you can get a close look. This woman, her expression is like this. Her tongue is out, her eyes, and her hair is all disheveled, black hair like this. You see the three gunas, Shiva and Mother Kali. This is the world. And if you're like Swami Atmagyananji, you can't wait to finish the ride. Get out. So, if it's out of divine love that this universe comes into existence, projected from His being, then it's out of divine grace that He brings us back to our divine abode. And that's what the left hand symbolizes. The divine grace. The impulse to return home. To uncover this magical show that's being projected before us. To uncover the reality of who we are. And this grace is used in a term called kripa. Kripa has two components. Kri means to do. Pa means to receive. And kripa, as I've understood, can have different stages. In the first stage, what's emphasized is the kri portion, doing. You take one step, the divine will take 10 steps towards you, but you've got to take the initial step. You've got to come here. He cannot do anything until you get here. So you've got to take the first step. As we evolve, we start to see that God's grace is always blowing. God's grace is always there. We just have to tune ourselves to it. We have to open up our sail to catch the wind. His grace is always flowing. We just have to learn to see it. And in the final stage of kripa, what do we see? That the person who was doing, the person who was receiving, that was the divine itself. This is really demonstrated to me when I first got to Belarmat. I went to Holy Mother's Shrine, and one of my observations was that at my time when I went, was you would see young novice monks come to Holy Mother and these old monks at Holy Mother's Shrine. And this is before the main arati at 3:30 in the morning. And these young novice monks you see are people who left their homes. They haven't made any friends. They're in an unknown place in Belarmat. So they haven't established themselves. They're here and they're crying to Mother. Mother, I need you. Please accept me. I don't have anybody else to call. You're my only one. Help me. And then the other ones you see, these old senior monks, it seems to me that they're saying that, Mother, it was you all the time. I didn't recognize you. You came in the form of this experience. You came in the form of this person. You came through all these things to help me evolve and grow. I didn't recognize you, but now I do. It was you all along. This is recognizing the divine's kripa, grace. So, when you see this photo, does it create a devotional mood within you? Are you seeking a relationship with someone you can pray to, worship, who will guide you? You know what we call the inner guru? They're known as the GPS. Do you know why GPS? What? That's true, but God pointing system. Are you seeking someone who's the divine author of this universe? A cosmic being who will respond to you? Does this photo create the feeling of surrender in you? So that whatever you give, I'll be satisfied with. Whatever you bring to me, I accept because you have brought it to me. I know God is love. So everything happening, even painful things, are filled with the love of God for my own upliftment. I just can't see them right now. I see them in a limited context. But in a larger context, I know it's your grace. Not that I'm going to do this and that, but the more and more I start to feel that it's your will that is guiding me. If it be your will, then I'll do this. Does this photo create the sense of, oh mother, I have to act, but please see to it that which I do is in accordance with your will. I have limited knowledge of what I should do in this situation. I cannot see the ends of my action. Oh Lord, thou whose eyes are open, who's omniscient to everything, omnipotent and all-powerful, please see to it that what I do is for the welfare of myself and others. Is this the feeling that we're getting? To me, one of the experiences I had when I felt surrender was going on a pilgrimage. Anybody has gone to Kailash by show of hands? Anybody on a pilgrimage? Okay. So what I discovered in a pilgrimage, especially Kailash, is that you start off at a 5-star hotel. And then it takes you about 8 days to get to the actual mountain Kailash itself. And then you do a parikrama for 3 days. You go around the mountain and then you come back. What happens in this trip is that you have everything. And one by one, things start getting taken away from you. You're breathing half the amount of air that you're breathing right here at an elevation about between 16 to 18,000 feet. And as you're walking, you start off in a group, but slowly you get to thinned out. The bathrooms go from the form to the formless. Okay? It's a real austere trip. And then there's a point in time when, as you're making this journey, when you have nobody to call to, you're by yourself, you have no resources to go to, no internet, no nothing. And at that point, sometimes you may hit a hailstorm, and you have no energy left. When everything is taken away from you, where ultimately do you go to?
There's nobody else to go to but the divine. There's like neti neti. Well, there's nobody here. Now it's only Shiva's here. And at that point, you surrender. The walls of your ego collapse. And then you feel something uplifting you, something carrying you, and then something to take you on the rest of your journey. This is the feeling of surrender.
So if the first photograph represents the transcendental aspect of God, the second photograph to me represents the immanent aspect of God. Nirupupam atishukshmam nishprapancham nireham. We meditate on Ramakrishna as extremely subtle, formless like space, the infinite dwelling within all beings, who is the Lord of all. This is the second stanza in the meditation dhyanam of Ramakrishna that we do in the pujas. God as Ishvara. Now, the third photograph of Ramakrishna was taken at Dakshineshwar in 1884. Ramakrishna was 48 years old, and it occurred Sunday at 9:30 a.m. According to Swami Harinamananda, this is what happened. Now listen closely.
Bhavanath Chatterjee, the master's devotee from Baranagar, wanted to take a photograph of the master. One day he requested him very strongly to give his consent, and on the afternoon of the next day brought a photographer along with him from Baranagar. He could not make the master agree. The master just went away near the Radhakanta Krishna temple. In the meantime, Narendra arrived on the scene and heard everything. He said, "Wait a bit, I shall put everything straight." Saying this, he went to the veranda to the west of the Radhakanta temple where Sri Ramakrishna was sitting and started a religious conversation with him. The master went into samadhi. Swamiji went and called the others and ordered them to get ready quickly to take the picture. In the state of samadhi, the master's body was bent on one side, and therefore the cameraman went to make him sit erect by softly adjusting his chin. But as soon as he touched his chin, the whole body of the master came up like a piece of paper. So light it was.
I heard it actually floated up.
Swamiji then told him, "Oh, what are you doing? Be quick. Get the camera ready." The cameraman took the exposure as hurriedly as possible. The master was completely unaware of this incident. After some days, when Bhavanath brought the printed copy of the photo, the master remarked, "This represents a high yogic state. This form will be worshipped in every home as time goes on."
Now I'd like you to take a good look at this picture, just as a camera exposure. Close your eyes and visualize it in your mind. What do we see? Ramakrishna is sitting with his hands lightly clasped, with his thumbs touching each other. The fingers are interlocked, his eyes half open, half closed. His lips appear half open. He's wearing a dhoti around his waist, which extends to his shoulders. Vaikunthanath Sanyal described Ramakrishna's complexion as fair, like a mixture of turmeric and red paint, but with a tinge of tan. His lips were reddish with vermilion, and he had a sweet fragrance coming from his body, like that of a lotus. Let's open our eyes. Now, there are some distinguishing marks that have been designated as signs of an avatar. Have you, anybody heard any of this, any of them? What's that? Softness. Okay, anybody else? Fragrance of lotus, okay. Anybody else? Okay. So, the first one that I'm going to tell you that has been told to me is Ajanubahu. His arms are very long, and they actually extended to his knees. This is according to Swami Brahmananji. Also, his eye line was way above his ears.
you look at my eye line, they're in a sort of matching up to my ear level. But his ears are way below his eye line level. And then somebody said, well, Swami, that's because his face is tilting up. No, if you look at the other photographs as well, you will see that his ears are way below his eye line. His eyes had the shape of lotuses. Another distinguishing mark, Snigna Varna. He had a shining complexion. Mother said his complexion was like the color of gold. Sama Vig Bhaktanga, he had symmetrical limbs. So we hear about this, but then I was asking, well, what's the source of this? Where do you get this designated marks from? And then eventually I discovered that it comes from the Valmiki Ramayana. And there it describes the characteristics of Ram. It was the conversation that when Hanuman was in Sri Lanka, had with Sita. And in this conversation, he was coming on behalf of Ram, and Sita wanted to know, prove you know Ram. So he started describing Ram's physical features. And this is part of the descriptions that are in there. Now, when you notice the back of the photo, you notice an archway. Why do you think there's an archway?
The photograph was dropped, and part of it broke off, and the photographer clipped it so it would be symmetrical.
Right. Did you hear that? So what happened was, this is how the story goes. Avinash Chandra, the photographer, he took the photograph, and then he was taking this glass plate to put it into the bag, and when he took it out, he was still frazzled by what he saw of Sri Ramakrishna, sort of floating up in the air. So he's being frazzled, he dropped the photograph and it cracked. And so couldn't take the photograph again, so he had to create an archway. And why an archway? Because it was a sign of Victorian prestige. Swami Vishuddhananda, what do they say about the photograph? It stated that when Ramakrishna saw this photograph, he took it and touched it to his head several times, saying, "This photo is nicely taken. The mood is very high, fully merged in him. Here the Lord is fully depicted in his own nature." This is the actual camera lens that took this photograph. It's in Champakur in India. Holy Mother had a photograph in her place. And she states that when Ramakrishna came, saw the photograph, said, "Then I saw the master taking his hand, the bell leaves and flowers kept there for worship, and offered them to the photograph." Now there's another incident in the gospel where Sri Ramakrishna is taking vermilion powder, this red powder, and in his room, he's touching it to all the gods and goddesses, except two photographs. One is Christ, and the other is his own picture. So I didn't understand why, if he did it the first case, why he didn't do this time. And I asked Swami Chaitanyaji Maharaj, and he said that for Christ, it's because we worship Christ in the tradition of Christian that it should be worshipped. So they don't put red vermilion powder, so we don't do this. And for Ramakrishna, he said he was feeling that Ramakrishna is the non-dual Brahman, and you don't worship Brahman. So, when we see this photograph, what does it show? What do we see here? Well, Givish Chandra Ghosh had said that if Ram's weapon as an avatar was his bow and arrow, and Krishna's weapon was his flute, and Chaitanya's was his begging bowl, what is Ramakrishna's weapon? His humility. Humility. He doesn't contradict anyone, but he embraces them. He gently corrects people by stating they're right, but he then pulls them into something more. He didn't contradict anybody's religion, but he would gently tell you it's more, maybe more than what you think it is. When you see this photograph, humility, it makes you, it's very endearing. It makes you come closer to him. It eliminates your fear and hesitation, and you develop faith and trust, a friendship, and you feel a sense of approachability. There's a term called sulabha, which means extremely easy to approach. And when we see this photograph, that's what we feel. He's available at all times, under any circumstance, and his love is unconditional. That's why Ramakrishna and Christ are referred to as Patita Pavana, the purifiers of the fallen. You know, in ancient India, we would see that during Shankaracharya's time, you would get into these debates, your religion against another religion, and if you lost the debate, then you would have to accept the person who defeated you. But Ramakrishna would never have any of that. He would show you, not only that, he would actually take on the mood or feeling that you had of the divine. So if you were a Shiva worshiper, it would appear he'd become Shiva. And he would enact like Shiva. If you were a person who loved Krishna, a Vaishnava person, to you, he would be Krishna. He would take on the mood and form sometimes of whatever your swabhava, your inner disposition wanted. Your swabhava indicates your swadharma. Your inner disposition indicates your path. And he would just show you your path. So, what you see in this photograph is more of an intimacy, an intimate relationship with the divine. No formalities. So if photograph number one was the transcendental aspect of the divine, photo number two was the immanent personal aspect of the divine, photo number three is the human aspect of the divine, the avatara aspect. Vidaritum avitirnam jnana bhakti prashantihi. In this, describes Ramakrishna as, I can't see there. Can you read the yellow, Patrick?
Born to bring knowledge and devotion. The whole thing?
Just the yellow part there. Uh-huh.
A heart was melted at the sufferings of others, and a beautiful form.
So this is the human aspect of the divine. And God made flesh. So we may ask ourselves now, what kind of mood does each photograph invoke within you? If Ramakrishna were here, sometimes he'd ask the question, what do you think of me? What do you think of me? And what he's asking is like, why do you value me? Why do you come to see me? What are the qualities within me that resonates within you? And to me, it's like looking at the same reality through three different lenses. The zoom lens, the telescopic lens, and ultimately through no lens. When we see the first photograph, we're connecting more with the human, the meditation photo on the bottom there. We're connecting more with Ramakrishna about with his human aspects rather than his divine aspects. You feel an intimacy, a connection. You feel when you're with your beloved, the whole world disappears and he only comes into focus. You feel presence in his surrounding. And you feel a closeness, like a friendship or someone who's a mother, someone you can confide to. Someone you can share experiences with and just be open and transparent. One of the things Ramakrishna loved was transparency. He didn't want any pretensions. If many of us, sometimes we come into spiritual life, we're projecting, we have an image. It's natural. We're all projecting something. And what the guru is waiting is until spiritual life is till you get rid of all these projections, till life itself crushes you, where you accept yourself as is. And once you accept yourself, now the guru says, now we can do some real work. So that, when you see him, you feel a presence of someone who's not judging you. No matter what you've done, you can confide. And when you see him also, you don't feel like a third person. You are here. You are my beloved. You think of him in the second person, not in the third person. Another sense is also you feel a sense of freedom. The divine does not make demands on you, only request. After all the teachings in the Bhagavad Gita, one of the very last slokas at the end, Krishna says, I give you these precious words of wisdom. Reflect on them and do as you choose. Somebody else has said, request, give direction to love, but demand stops the flow of love. It's your choice. They always give you the freedom. When you're ready, when you're hungry, you will come. So there's an intimacy, a sense of love to our beloved, a closeness that we feel at photo number one, the human aspect. When we see photo number two, what do we see? Oh, sorry. Photo number two, we see not so much the human aspect, but more the Aishwarya aspect, his powerful aspect. We see him as Ishvara, the cosmic power, the cosmic being, rather than the human being. When Arjuna was shown Sri Krishna's Vishwarupa Darshana, he had only known Sri Krishna in his human form as an avatar. Upon seeing and experiencing his vision, Arjuna realized that Sri Krishna is Ishvara himself, and he was left in a state of awe, wonder, and amazement. So when you see this second photograph, is there a feeling of awe, submission, and respect towards his vastness? Do you feel his omnipotence, his omniscience, his omnipresence? How vast the divine is and how small we are. And then you're awestruck by his power. And the relationship may be one where you feel maybe he is my master and I feel like his servant. And everything is dependent by his will. And you feel a sense of surrender. Is that the feeling you see when you see photograph number two? And in photo number three, you, who is there to express any feeling? You are one with that. Aham Brahmasmi. Aham Brahmasmi. You are that. I am that. You rise above any emotions. You are just that. So I'm going to leave you with some music and just what does the image saying to you.
The words I have to say may well be simple, but they're true. Until you give your love, there's nothing more that we can do. Love is the opening door. Love is what we came here for. No one could offer you more. Do you know what I mean? Have your eyes really seen?
च श्रुतजिह्वे न च घ्राणनेत्रे न च व्योमभूमिर् न तेजो न वायु चिदानन्दरूप शिवोऽहं शिवोऽहं चिदानन्दरूप शिवोऽहं
Thank you.